All right, welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us on Facebook this morning, and we just appreciate you being here so much. And we had a little difficulty trying to set things up and get things started the right way. So anyway, join us, and we're ready to go right into the service. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for this day that you've given us the ability to still share your word. And we ask God that you'll just bless the people today, bless the service, and bless those who are tuning in and watching. And we just pray, God, that your Holy Spirit would move in a great and a mighty way. Amen.
Well,
with the adverse weather that we have, we wanted to be sure to be able to share the Word of God with you and to share worship with you. We're asking Pastor Bobby to come down. And if you have any prayer needs, you have anything that you need from God, just ask him as Pastor Bobby. Praise. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank y'all so much for tuning in.
Amen.
And Father, we are here this morning, Lord God, to just worship and glorify you. And I want you to understand, if you're here in the building, he's with you. If you're at home, he's with you. I don't care where you are today, he is with you. He said he'd never leave you or forsake you, and he never has and he never will. Let's pray. Father, God, we thank you so much for this awesome opportunity to be here today, Lord God, to worship you, to glorify you, to magnify you, O God. We pray your anointing be on the message this morning, your anointing be on the word. May it bring healing and hope and restoration, Father. And God, we'll give you the praise, the honor, and the glory for it all. God, we just thank you. We thank you so much for this awesome, awesome, awesome opportunity, God. We call it on you. We praise you, O God. For you, O God, are a merciful, loving, and kind God. And we ask that you would meet with us today, Father, by the power of your Holy Spirit, your resurrection power. In Jesus' precious name we pray. God, we thank you, we thank you, and we thank you.
Amen.
We're going to have Pastor Ken come and deliver the word.
Amen. Again, thank you, Facebook, and those who will be watching later on YouTube for tuning in this morning. We have some difficulties, so that we've been working on it and trying to get things straight with the camera this morning and the lighting and so forth. So thank you for bearing with us. If you are watching today, we welcome your comments and thank you for tuning in. Again, we know that because of the adverse weather conditions outside, we've had to cancel our services today, and that means that we're canceling movie night tonight. So we'll give you another date for the movie night. Amen. We've been looking at spiritual warfare for the past several months, and we've been dealing with the armor of God for the past several weeks, and that is the armor of the believer. We have seen from the prophet Isaiah that it is the same armor that Christ wore when he walked on the earth and he brought salvation to mankind. You can reference this to Isaiah the 11th chapter and the 5th verse and Isaiah 59 verses 16 through 18. But now we're looking at each piece of the armor separately. And the first piece of the armor that we examined was the armor of the belt of truth. That word truth here is aletheia. That's in the Greek. It means that which is revealed in a tangible way before our very eyes. In other words, it's so real that you can not only see it, it's like you can touch it, you can hear it, you can taste it. You know that you know that you know. But it's known because it's revealed supernaturally to you by the Spirit of Truth, the third person of the Trinity. See, this is where the Word becomes a living voice speaking directly to you.
Amen.
A living Word spoken by a living voice.
Amen.
1 Corinthians, the 2nd chapter, the 14th verse states, the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him. I wonder why we spend so much time arguing with foolish people about the Bible. Hello? They say, nor can he know them. And that word know means not just simply know of, but have a knowledge of. Because they are, listen, spiritually discerned. And the only way they can be spiritually discerned is that you have that Spirit of Truth indwelling you. And the only way that can take place is that you have received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior.
Amen.
See, that's a verse that you hear probably many of you have ever attended a funeral. You know that I have heard this verse in the scripture too, in 2 Corinthians, 2nd chapter, and I believe it's beginning at the 9th verse where it said, eye has not seen, ear has not heard, neither has it entered into the heart, the things that God has prepared for them. But you see, they leave out the 10th verse. Friend, the 10th verse says, but God. I love but God. But God has revealed them to who? To us, right? By the Holy Spirit. John 16:33. When the Spirit of truth comes, that third person of the Godhead, the Holy Spirit, He will guide you into all truth.
Amen.
In fact, Jesus said, and He would teach us of the things that Christ has in mind for us. So what we saw with the belt of truth, the belt of Aletheia, is our first line of defense. It's the revelation of this truth. See, the verse said, you shall know the truth in John 8th chapter, and the truth shall set you free. When we taught how that Satan's greatest weapon is deception. But our greatest weapon is truth. One way you tell the counterfeit is by knowing the real. And when we know the real, when we know the real truth, then Satan cannot come in and deceive us. Because you see, that word deception, we've taught and taught and taught, means it's while they take the word and they twist it.
Amen.
It's the misrepresentation of the word of truth. But when you know the truth, then you can realize and see when they're trying to twist it and make it say something that is not saying. So remember, the belt of truth was to be a guide, was to be truth to us. And it was like a girdle that fit over the loins area. At the stomach and the loins area. The loins represent our source of life.
Amen.
Our source of power. And the belt of the Roman soldier protected his very life. And it was that which held the rest of his equipment together.
Amen.
As does the word of God for the believer. So I believe Paul mentioned this verse, the belt of truth first, because not only does it hold all things together, it's the revelation of who God is.
Yes.
And if you have no revelation of God is, that's no way that you can receive Christ into your life and have an understanding of Him. So that's the first piece of equipment that Paul mentioned to us. And last week, we spoke about need for the breastplate of righteousness. That breastplate, it covers the Roman soldier, it covers from the neck down to the thighs. And it actually was two pieces. It protected the front and the back of the Roman soldier. Listen to me now. I'm going to say that again. See, that breastplate not only covered his front, but it covered his back. Can I tell you this morning, God's got your back? Can I tell you this morning, when you have on the belt of truth, hello? When you have on this belt of truth, and you have this revelation of who the Lord is, and you know the truth of God's word, God's got your back, and Satan,
amen.
Now hear me, the devil cannot sneak up on you. The devil can ambush you when you're walking in the truth.
Amen.
Now, not only was this breastplate of righteousness from the front and back, that this breastplate was made of both metal and thick metal and thick leather, weaved together so as not to confine the Roman soldier in battle. See, legalism and religion seeks to confine God. That would seek to put God in a box. But when we have on the breastplate of righteousness, you're not going to put God in a box.
He won't fit in
there. You see, let me tell you something. Jesus, you couldn't put Him in a box. When He walked this earth, He healed people and delivered people in so many different ways.
Yes, He did.
He spit in people's faces. He made a set of eyes out of mud. Think about that. He reached down and created, we're made from the dust of the earth. A man born blind, a man born without eyesight, and He made him a set of eyeballs and placed them right on his, where they're supposed to be. Hey, there was times when He laid hands on some. There was times when He sent the word to heal him. And there was times that He even rebuked someone and then healed him. You cannot put Him in a box. Now, we could liken the Roman breastplate to a bulletproof vest. Like law enforcement words today. And the metaphor here that we saw last week is that the heart represents our inner man, our spirit man. It represents who we really are, our very soul. We brought out how it's the seat of our thoughts, our motives, and emotions.
Amen.
And we saw where Proverbs 4:23 says, keep your heart. Another watch out spirit man. Keep your heart with all vigilance.
Amen.
For from it flow the fountains of life.
Amen.
And so what we saw last week, the reason that we need this breastplate of righteousness to cover our heart and to protect our spirit man is because Satan is going to come after it. Yes. See, you are a triune being. 1 Thessalonians 5:23, Hebrews 4:12 teaches that we are a spirit, that we possess a soul, and we live in a body of flesh.
Amen.
See, we are spirit. We possess a soul living in a body of flesh. And the spirit and soul is going to be the first place that he's going to attack. See, we know that our spirit and soul is already at war with the flesh and the world. So what makes you think that these demons of hell are not going to seek to try to come after it, to bring confusion and so forth? Let me explain why. See, our spirit and soul has an endless existence. It is separate, at the same time it's intertwined together. It has an endless existence. And you see, your spirit, man, is your God consciousness. It is your spirit consciousness. Your soul is your self-consciousness. You know, the seat of your emotions and so forth. And your flesh is your world consciousness. So our heart and soul is our core being. It's the real us. And Satan and all the demons of hell, along with the flesh and the world, are going to attack the very core of our being. Because you see, the enemy knows that if he can get our hearts, he too can get a hold of our soul, and he can mortally and fatally wound us. See, Satan, he knows why we're the most vulnerable. And if he can get us here, and by the way, it may not be the same for each of us. That might be an area in my life where I'm weak and someone else is strong. But it might be why I'm strong in this area and they may be weak in this area. And Satan knows our weaknesses. Paul made mention of that. He said that eating meat for one did not hinder thy walk of faith or held him in any condemnation. But then he said for another brother who was a weaker brother, it would become an offense and then it would bring condemnation. And Satan knows these areas to attack. That is why we so need the belt of Aletheia. The revealed truth concerning the breastplate of righteousness. See, if we get a hold of the truth, the real truth of what this breastplate represents to the child of God, can I tell you, we'll begin to live without fear. We'll begin to live without depression and discouragement and condemnation and shame. Then this is the importance of the breastplate of righteousness. And God has provided it for our very defense. So how can we protect this most vulnerable area, our heart, our spirit man, our very soul? The breastplate of righteousness.
Amen.
So what is it? And this is why we left off last week. What is this breastplate of righteousness? What is the metaphor here? What does it represent? It represents the righteousness, the right standing, the righteousness, the perfection that we get from God through faith in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
In other words, it's Jesus' righteousness that becomes ours the very minute
Amen.
That we are
Amen.
Saved. But too often, and here's the deception, child of God. Too often the deception is, remember, deception is the misrepresentation of the truth. When we think that we are not righteous enough because, and that we're not holy enough because we're still in this body of flesh. And so we try to be holy, we attempt to be holy, we attempt to live right. But the fact of it is, see, you're not right simply by your works, and we'll deal with that. But you're right because the Word of God says you are.
Hallelujah.
Now, it's not our own righteousness, it's not our works, but it's because of His righteousness. And that's the truth of our righteousness. The truth is, this breastplate of righteousness is His righteousness covering us.
Thank you, Lord.
See, in other words, the best defense against Satan is to remember who you are when you become a follower of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
When you're saved, when we're pardoned, when we're forgiven, when we testify because of what Jesus did for us at Calvary, at the cross, then we are made alive in Him. Ephesians 2:5 said, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. You know, in the English language, we have three tips. And I never realized how much I was going to need English and so forth when I was in high school. I thought I was just trying to get by. But in the English language, it's only three tenses. The past, the present, the future. But the Greek language in which the scripture was written, they had several different tenses and several different meanings. There are several past tenses. Now, the aorist tense here means that once we've been made alive, it cannot be undone. That's what this aorist tense means. You can't undo it. You can't delete it. You can't just erase it. The fact of it is, once it has been done, once Jesus paid the price for our sins at Calvary, and once we accept that forgiveness, it cannot be undone. What Jesus did at Calvary cannot be undone.
Jesus.
And we've been made alive in Christ Jesus, which means it cannot be undone. Which means we have been given the righteousness of Christ, which means it cannot be undone. It's His righteousness imputed unto us. That means it's been credited to us. It's been attributed to us. It's been assigned to us. Yes. And it characterized our lives as we follow Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
And it cannot be undone. Romans 4:11. See, when you receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, the Holy Spirit comes and indwells us.
Amen.
And therefore we are made right in the sight of the Father.
Amen.
And then something, and that's in that heavenly realm, and then something starts in the earthly realm. It's called the process of sanctification.
Amen.
That's why we're being changed from the inside out. Now, religion and legalism tries to change us from the outside first, and it doesn't work. All it does is make you miserable, puts you under condemnation and guilt. But when the Spirit of God works the other way, works inside of us, and He changes us, and it cannot be reversed, then when these changes begin to take place, we begin to walk in the truth of who God is and who we are.
Thank you, Lord.
See, when Satan attacks us, here's how we can increase our defenses. We do it through the transformation that the Spirit of God is working out in our lives.
Wow.
See, Paul wants us to defend ourselves with the righteousness that is ours in Christ. Not with our works. Not trying to be good. Now, we need to be good. We'll talk about that. Yeah, we need to live right, but the fact of it is we cannot live right without Christ. And the fact of it is, because we're still in this body of flesh, guess what? We're going to mess up. But through His righteousness, that is the Spirit producing in our lives, that which is called sanctification. See, even though we have a new heart, we still live in a fallen world, and we live in a body of flesh. And we're going to struggle with the world. We're going to struggle with sins that so easily entangles us. That's why we're told to guard our heart and not be bound by the snares of sin. See, it's not so much that we may lose our salvation, but it's the fact that we cannot grow in holiness unless we guard our heart and live in obedience. And this is called progressing in sanctification. So how does this breastplate work? Jesus' righteousness as a defense, which is His imputed righteousness to us, is one of the aspects of this breastplate, which is the righteousness of Jesus.
Yeah.
That's given to us again. I know I've mentioned this several times, but I need to get this across. The minute that you're saved. Now hear me. This is what it means. Our position in Christ Jesus, the very moment we're saved, is that we're made righteous in the sight of God. That is what the Father sees. And that is the only thing that He can see. See, He cannot look on sinful flesh. So when He looks upon us, He looks upon the righteousness of His Son. But then 1 Corinthians 1:30. It is because of Him that you are in Christ Jesus. Listen. Who has become for us wisdom from God? That is our righteousness, our holiness,
yeah,
our redemption. I'm holy not because I look holy. I'm holy because He has made me holy.
Hallelujah.
I live right not because I can live right, but because I live right in Him.
Hallelujah.
See, when Jesus Christ went to the cross, He took all of our sins, that's all the sins of humanity,
yes, He did.
Past, present, and future. I mean, listen, this is the greatest transaction ever to occur in all of eternity.
Wow.
Jesus took our sins upon Himself. He became, He knew no sin. He could not sin, and yet He became sin for us according to Scripture. That means every one of us, that means you. That means He paid the price for our sin with His death. But listen to what else He did. See, when we put our trust in Jesus for eternal life, not only does He forgive us of our sins, He gives us His right standing with the Father. Can you imagine that? I mean, the Father looked at the Son and can find no wrong in Him. The Father looked at the Son and He sees the reflection of Himself. Do you realize that? And according to the Scripture, then He's given us that same righteousness, so that when Jesus, when the Father looks upon us, He sees His Son. He sees the righteousness of His Son because we have been redeemed. See, we become positionally in heaven in Christ, righteous before a holy God. We couldn't do that before. We couldn't do it before. No matter how hard we try. But now we can stand in the very presence of God in the righteousness of Christ. See, our sinful flesh could not contain the righteousness of God. So what happened? Well, remember the burning bush? Many of you have heard the story of Moses and the burning bush over in Exodus, the third chapter. Well, Moses is walking, you know, kept the casual day in the desert, in the wilderness, and he looks over and he sees the bush on fire. Now, this is not uncommon. This will happen all the time in the desert. My wife and I have even seen this happen in the desert, in the Arizona. Or just an old bull rush just standing out there in the middle of nowhere, and lightning hit it and suddenly caught on fire. But there was something different about this bush. See, fire can consume the bush. Fire would destroy the bush. But this bush was not being consumed. This bush could not contain fire, and yet it was containing fire. And the reason was God transformed the nature of that bush to contain the fire. And the only way that we could receive the indwelling of the Spirit of Christ, the only way that we may righteousness in His sight, is through the transformation power of the Holy Spirit. 2 Corinthians 5:17.
Thank you.
Therefore, if any of us be in Christ,
amen,
we are a new creation, a new species, something that never existed before.
Amen.
And it happened because He came into our life. He changed us. And so this breastplate of righteousness that we need to put on enables us to stand in the very presence of God. Not on our goodness, not on our works. Do you realize our sinners that sometimes does more good works than some Christians? But that's our righteousness.
Amen.
It's not His righteousness. It is our righteousness is and our works is null when it comes to right standing with God. But His righteousness, again, I want to mention, enables us to enter into the very throne room of God. So when we pray, you need the breastplate of righteousness.
Yeah.
Do you hear me? When we pray, we need the breastplate of righteousness. And let me pause here for a second. I didn't want to mention this. I want us to remember that our works are important. Works are important.
Amen.
Works doesn't save us, but works follow salvation. Work does not produce salvation. Hello? Works does not produce salvation, but works follows salvation after we come to Christ. And you heard me preach how important our works are. Because remember, at the judgment seat of Christ, it's not the judgment of our works of righteousness. It would be the evaluation of our works of righteousness. See, heaven in the millennium and eternity will not be the same for every child of God. It will be different for each one of us, and it will be according to our works of righteousness. I mean, even our wedding garments will be determined by works of righteousness. Revelations 19:8. It's called the righteous acts of God's holy people. So works are important. And I encourage you, you can go online at EWCE Online YouTube and go back to 2018 or 2019. And we have several messages concerning how works are important. But remember, works does not produce righteousness. Hello? Works does not produce salvation. But works will follow salvation. And our righteousness in Christ will cause us to live right in Christ, and it will produce good works.
Amen.
But let me tell you, remember, we need this breastplate of righteousness when we pray, especially. You've heard the devil whisper to you when you weren't to pray before. God's not going to hear you. Do you remember that sin you did the other day? How you got in the flesh? How you got angry with that guy that cut you off in traffic? How you got angry at that guy when you was first in line at McDonald's and someone stepped in front of you? And all those thoughts that raced through your mind? See, remember, Satan is the accuser of the brethren. And the scripture gives us a strong, detailed incidence of this that took place in heaven. Listen, you are the righteousness of Christ. Some of you are going to get mad at this. Some of you are getting ready to stir up some religious spirit. I'm getting ready to stir up some legalism in some people. But the fact of it is, listen, you are the righteousness of Christ even in sinful flesh. Now again, if we don't have a license to sin, we ought to live right. But from when we do mess up, it does not change our position of standing in Christ Jesus. We are still righteous and perfect before the Lord. Philippians 3:9. Paul writes, and be found in him, not having my own righteousness. Listen to what Paul says there. Not having my own righteousness, which is from the law. In other words, not having my own righteousness, which is by my works or by my struggling to be holy. But that righteousness which is through faith in Christ. The righteousness which is from God by faith.
Amen.
It's what Christ did at Calvary and his resurrection. Why we do not have to no longer worry when the accuser accuses us before the Father. Because when the Father looks at us, he sees we are clothed in the righteousness of his Son. Now let me tell you what that's called. In theologians' term, we call it positional righteousness. Positional righteousness. It's one of the ways that Satan attacks us to accuse us. He says, well, what? You sin again and you're no good. God can never love anyone like you. You keep messing up. How many times do you think God's going to forgive you? But Jesus taught us over in Matthew, the 18th chapter, it's called unconditional forgiveness.
Yeah.
That forgiveness that Jesus talked about symbolizes boundlessness. In other words, listen, we are forgiven before we ask for forgiveness.
Thank you, Lord.
Because we're in his heart. Now keep in mind there are consequences to our sins when we do mess up. Because you see, Christ is not going to judge us for those sins at the bema judgment seat of Christ. Again, that's a place of evaluation. You think he's going to wait till you leave planet Earth and get up in front of him that he's going to judge those sins? Brother, he's going to do it right here now on planet Earth. He's not going to let you put it off. He's going to deal with sin in a believer's life now. And he does it by the Holy Spirit, and he does it with the belt of truth by revealing to us what those things are when we mess up. Let me illustrate it this way. My people have heard me say this a number of times. You know, as a pastor, let's say one night I just finally get fed up. I've had it up to here. I hear up to here. I've had it with my wife. I've had it with my children. I've had it with my neighbor. I've had it with the deacons. I've had it with the elders. I say, you know what? From here. And I go out and buy me a big bottle of, what do you call that stuff? Jack Daniels. I was going to say Boone Farms, whatever. But anyway, and you know, I drink that thing and I get so totally drunk out of my head. And I look over at my hand, and I said, you know, I don't need two. I got one, so I'm going to get rid of this one. I take an axe and I cut that hand off. But also, as I see the foolishness of what I just did, they wrap that pan up and rush me to the hospital, and they're able to, you know, save my life and everything. And the next morning, I wake up and I realize how foolish I have been. I realize what I have done. I cry out for forgiveness from God, and immediately I'm forgiven. But the consequence of what I did is still that. Do you hear me, believe? The consequence of my sin, even though I'm forgiven, is still there. There are consequences when we sin. But the fact of it is, in Christ Jesus, I am made righteous. I'm forgiven. One of the key ways that Satan attacks our hearts, the way he goes after our spirit, as I mentioned already, he's the accuser. Revelation 12:10 calls him the accuser of our brothers. Sisters, that includes you too. Who accuses us day and night. Wait a minute. Day and night before our God. That's what it says. He's the accuser of the brother. He's accusing us, the church, day and night. Wow. Before who? God. See, Satan loves to point out all our flaws. Hello? He loves to point out all the mistakes that we make. And believe me, I have a lot of flaws that he can point out. So he's right. He's right. See, when Satan attacks us this way, you know what we need? The breastplate of righteousness. See, we need a righteousness that doesn't come from us as our defense. If we try to argue with our own righteousness, if we try to make excuses, if we try to reason it out, listen, we're doomed. It's like one preacher says, our integrity, our righteousness at its best is but as wax before the devil. And a wax shield, a wax breastplate is just not going to cut it. In fact, what you will learn is this. The more you grow in Christ, the more aware are you going to find of your own unrighteousness. You're going to find you have no righteousness of your own. See, the more you grow in faith, the more you'll know that your own righteousness is no defense against Satan. And yet, too, the more you grow in Christ, the greater the truth you come to realize is the righteousness of Christ that the Father sees. As I mentioned, ours is nothing but filthy rags. But listen closely, because I don't want to miss this. I want you to get a hold of this. Now, the breastplate of righteousness symbolizes Christ's righteousness given to us, and it symbolizes our position in the heavens. But also, the breastplate of righteousness, now listen, symbolizes the Christian sanctification. We are positional righteous in Christ, but through the sanctification afforded to us by the Spirit in the Word, and by the way, in the truth, the veil of truth, Jesus said, sanctify them with your word. Your word is truth. I believe it's John 17:17. See, our position of righteousness in Christ in heaven through sanctification here on earth, we're becoming in practice what we are already positional. What's our position? Righteousness of Christ. See, what God is doing for sanctification in our walk with Christ here in this earth, he's teaching us to live in the light of what we already are. I'll say it again. Through sanctification, he's teaching us how to live according to what we are already in heaven. And that's through sanctification. Yet the problem with many of us in the church is we want to wear the positional armor, but not the practical armor. And you're going to need both in this warfare. Dr. Jeremiah said this way, if we are righteous in him above, then he should be righteous in us down here. 1 John 3:10. In this the children of God and the children of the devil, so you're either a child of God or you're of the devil. Well, I don't serve the devil. Are you saved? Are you a believer? Are you a Christian? Have you received Christ as your Lord and Savior? Because now, he is your Father. You may not want to recognize him. You may not want to receive him. You might want to say, no, I don't have anything to do with him. But the fact of it is, he's ruling over your life. He does it through the world, the flesh, and through your very being. And the only way not to be a part of that family is to become a part of the family of God.
Amen.
And thus receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. That's the only way. So it says, if this the children of God and the children of the devil are manifest, whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor is he who does not love his brother. Practice righteousness. 1 Timothy 6:11. But you, O man of God, flee these things and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, and gentleness. In other words, pursue God and pursue to live right according to your position in Christ in heaven.
Amen.
So what do? We put on the breastplate of Jesus' righteousness. Now I know I've got to close, but I want to share one of my favorite part of scriptures from the Old Testament. It's found in the book of Zechariah, the 3rd chapter. Zechariah presents it to us in the form of a vision. I've mentioned it many times here at Emmanuel Worship Center, so my people no doubt are familiar with this story. It's about Joshua, the high priest of Israel. He's standing positional in heaven before God. He's on planet earth. But remember now, the high priest, the Jewish high priest, came before God once a year on the Day of Atonement for the sins of the people of Israel, the sins of the nation of Israel. And so before he would come to this particular day, that would take weeks of preparation, weeks of purification to prepare him for that day, to make sure that he was cleansed and that he was prepared and ready to stand before a holy God to represent the people of Israel. In fact, it is said that on this Day of Atonement, they would tie a rope around his foot and he would go into the Holy of Holies, and if he had not been purified enough or made cleansed enough, he would fall dead in the very presence of God. And they would ring that little bell, and if it wouldn't ring, they'd have to pull that rope and pull that dead horse back out, you see. And so these priests made sure that they followed the ceremonial cleaning that God outlined for them in the Torah, to make sure that they would stand before a holy God to represent the people of Israel. And so they would go through this process of purification. But now I want you to look what happened when Joshua the high priest came before God. Now he's gone through all the works of purification, all the ceremonial works of purification and cleansing. But then, listen to what the scripture says. Then he shall meet Joshua the high priest standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to do what? To accuse him. Remember, he accuses us day and night, 24 hours a day. So listen, it said Satan standing at the right hand to accuse him. Now Joshua, here's this high priest going through this ceremony cleaning, was standing before the angel, clothed with filthy garments. See, Zechariah in a vision sees Joshua standing before God after all these weeks of preparation. But Satan is there too to accuse him. Now it says in verse 3 that Joshua was dressed in filthy clothes as he stood before the angel. You know, in the original language, it says his clothes was covered with ephraim. Think about that. It is a picture of how you and I look to God as we come before him in all of our righteousness. And so, therefore, on this Day of Atonement, that's big trouble because Joshua's unclean. There's no way he can stand before God, and Satan is out to accuse him. No, that's a good picture of our condition before God, apart from Jesus Christ. Even when we come before the Lord, you know, and people say, you know, so many people try to change before they accept Christ. I heard people say, well, there's a lot of things I need to quit doing before I get saved. No. You come to the Father. He accepts you in spite of who you are. Notice it didn't say he accepts you as you are. He accepts you in spite of who you are. All you are cleansed. I don't care what it is. You can be the worst of the sinners. I'm just not going into detail, but you could be the wickedest of the wicked and come before God, just as Joshua did you. And you see, even after all the preparation that we can do, no matter how much we try to make ourselves clean, we show up covered in filth. And Satan loves to point that out. But look what happens when Satan accuses Joshua. Because the same thing happens when Satan and his demons accuses us. And the Lord spoke in our behalf. I'm glad he speaks in my behalf. I'm glad that I don't have to speak up for myself, that Jesus speaks up for me.
Amen.
And so the Lord said to Satan, the Lord rebuked you, O Satan. The Lord has chosen Jerusalem. The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you. He said, is not this a brand plucked from the fire? Can I tell you, you child of God, this morning, every one of us been plucked from the fires of hell. Now here's Joshua standing before the angel, clothed with filthy garments. The Lord rebuked Satan in our behalf, and the angel of the Lord said to those who were standing before him, and this is what he says, who we stand before him and are coming to Christ, who we receive him as our Lord and Savior, he says, remove the filthy garments from him.
Hallelujah.
And to him he said, behold, I have taken your iniquity away from you. No, iniquity means uncleanness. It means sin and transgression. And so when we come before the Lord and ask him our forgiveness and so forth, he removes our filthy garments and he takes away the iniquity in our life. And this is what it says. And I will clothe you with pure vestments, with pure garments. See, we're clothed in the righteousness of Christ. And then it says this, let them put a clean turban on his head.
Amen.
So they put a clean turban on his head and clothed him with garments. And the angel of the Lord was standing by. I don't know about you, but I absolutely love this. See, it's a vision of what happens to us when God saves us through Jesus Christ. Before Satan can even speak, the angel says, take off those filthy clothes. And then the angel says to Joshua, see, I have taken away your sin, and I will put fine garments on you.
Zechariah
3:4. See, we come to Christ, God wipes all our uncleanness and provide clothes that we ourselves could not provide for ourselves. He reclothes us in the very presence of God. He even gives us a turban, which at that time would have signified royalty. Here we come before God covered with ecrimen. And in God's presence, he's given ceremonial, pure garments as a sign that God accepts him and accepts the people that he represents.
Amen.
A great picture of what God does for us. A great picture of the righteousness that can be our defense when Satan comes after our heart.
Hallelujah.
We can remind him God's taken our filthy rags, our filthy clothes. And he's clothed us not with our righteousness, not with our good works. Don't judge me by that. Judge me by his righteousness. 2 Corinthians 5:21. For our sake, he made him, the Father made him, Jesus, to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. So my friend, this morning, let me close. When Satan accuses us, we have no righteousness of our own to defend ourselves. We can't say, well, you know, I go to church. I read my Bible every morning and every night and throughout the day. I pray three times a day. I pray the morning, the afternoon, the evening. You might say, well, you know, I pray continually. And, you know, I give my tithes and offering to the church. And I pat the preacher on the back. And I do this. Look, those things are good. You need to be doing every one of them. You need to be in church. You need to be reading your word. That's the only way you can get the bell of truth, the revelation of who God is.
Amen.
You need to be giving your offerings and your tithes because God uses you
Amen.
To support his work on earth. Hear what I'm saying? He uses you. And in doing so, he wants to bless you because you're willing to allow your time and your finances and your abilities, your gifts and calling to be used for the kingdom of God. So God wants to bless you in return for that. And the more you do, the more the blessing. That's what the scripture says. He who gives in abundance, reaps in abundance. He who gives in less, reaps less. But you see, we need to remind Satan not about our good works, because he can punch holes in our good works.
Yes, he can.
He can say, oh, yeah, that good work you did? Yeah, what was the motives behind it? Oh, did you want to be seen by the people? Didn't you get upset when the pastor got up and 10 of you, they did the same thing, and he mentioned 9 of you and didn't mention you? He forgot about you. Didn't you get upset about that? But what was your motive? Hello? See, Satan punched holes in our motives, our works. See, what we remind him about is, this is the devil. We're clothed in the purchased righteousness of Jesus Christ. I've got on the breastplate of righteousness. I agree with you, adversary, but I want to remind you, as I remind myself, Satan, Jesus died for my sins, and now I have the righteousness of Christ Jesus.
Thank you. Good word.
Realize that the only way we can stand before God is based on the righteousness of Christ. Amen. And you have it.
That's right.
Thank you, Lord.
That's right.
Thank you, Lord.
This is what the deception is. Satan doesn't want to believe that we have it because he wants to pull out our hearts. He wants to nitpick us for the even the littlest thing. If he can't find something major, he finds some small things. Anything he can do just to keep your mind and your body and your spirit bound up where you cannot walk in the truth and with the belt of truth around you and the breastplate of righteousness. But when you get this truth, you can say, I'm free. And he who the Son makes free is free indeed.
Amen.
You shall know the truth, and the truth sets you free. So you know what? I'm not going to worry about my mess up, my slips up, my mistakes.
Give them to God.
They're in the past. God's not going to bring them back up to me. I'm going to walk on in the righteousness of Christ from day to day and fulfill the calling of God upon the life of the church here and now. And you will not hinder me.
Amen.
You will not stand to me.
Thank you,
Lord.
See, theologians call this imputed righteousness. That God has credited to us all the righteousness of Jesus Christ through faith. So again, not about our righteousness, his righteousness. And can I tell you something? I like this. If you don't get this, I don't know what else to do. Satan cannot attack the righteousness of Christ.
You
can pass
it.
And when we put on the breastplate, he can't pierce it to get through to our hearts, to our spirit. So in closing, let me ask you, are we doing this? Are we putting on the breastplate of his righteousness?
Amen.
Because we can't stand against the attacks of Satan if we're trusting in our works and our own righteousness.
Amen.
Your own works of righteousness. Have you looked to Jesus for the righteousness that he provides, because it is your defense against the attacks of this evil one? So, let me go a little bit further, can I? I might as well do it anyway. Even if you trusted in Jesus' righteousness, is this the breastplate that you were when Satan comes after your heart?
That's right.
See, it's possible to have trust in Christ and functionally live as if it all depends on us. It is possible to have trusted in Jesus Christ and to constantly live as if it all depends not on him, but on us. Remember, we preached several weeks ago. He fights our battles.
Yes, he does.
The battle is the Lord's. He fights our battles. What do? We just obey. Moses told the people at the Red Sea, stand still. See the salvation of the Lord. He said, the battle is the Lord, the Lord shall fight for you. And then God parted the Red Sea.
Amen.
And here, some of us, we look at God's part to receive for it, and we look and say, wow, man, that's something. Look at that. I mean, it's from one side to the other. Look at it. Wow. Man. Better get me a boat. My works. Better get me a boat so I can get over there. I don't know if I can, you know, suppose I get halfway through the water comes in the office. It's not, because you see, you're under God's protection. Amen. You are in the breastplate of righteousness. Hello? The battle is his. Our obedience is to walk. He makes a way, we walk through it. Jehoshaphat, he cried out to the Lord. We're not prepared. We're not ready for this great army that's come up against us. I mean, you know, it's only 15 miles out from us, and they're marching. And the Lord, through a prophet, I love when a word comes from God. See, this was a rhema word. This was God speaking directly to Israel, saying, and the prophet said, the battle is not yours. The battle is the Lord's, and he shall fight for you.
He said, he got this.
I'm glad of that. Oh, but by the way, get your worshipers together, get your army together, and go ahead and go out there and meet them. Wait a minute. You just said you're fight for us. You say you're going to fight. How come we got to go out there in front of him? You say you're going to fight for us. No. The Lord's going to fight for you. You just got to be obedient. You see, let me share with you what happens when you're obedient. See, he had stayed there, and God had delivered them. Well, they would have been delivered, but guess what? They would have missed out. See, God wants you to be part of the blessing. See, they run on and they march out towards the enemy. The Bible said that God brought confusion among the enemy. Don't you love when God does that?
Woo-hoo!
He brought confusion among the enemy. And when they got there, the enemy had fled and left everything behind. And there they were in the valley of blessing. And it took them several days to gather all the spoils. See, that's why God wants you to march. He's going to fight for you, but he wants you to enjoy the spoils. All we have to do is be obedient, put on the breastplate of righteousness, and enjoy the spoils of his righteousness. Let me say a little bit more. I know I get three closing, this is the third. See, what Paul means when he says that we put on the breastplate of righteousness, that we ought to be to remind ourselves every day that we don't stand based on our record. We stand because we are in union with Jesus Christ by the Holy Spirit. We stand because of the work of Jesus Christ that cannot be undone. So here it is. I got one more part of this message that we'll speak next week. But when Satan comes after our hearts, when he attacks the spirit man, we can stand with courage. We can stand knowing the truth that the breastplate of Jesus' righteousness can handle any attack that Satan brings on you.
Amen.
I hope you got a good word today. I really miss you being here. We miss our people. We love seeing our people. And we're so thankful for those who are now able to come out and join us in our inside services. And then those who are not ready to come inside yet, join us on the outside. Our services are every Sunday at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. And for those who are not able to come on the inside, 10 on the inside, and some cannot because of their immune system and so forth and all, they can listen to us on 87.9 FM. And enjoy being here. And then we love to come out and wave at you and talk with you and just be in fellowship with you. And we're so glad that we're able, for those who are not able even to come out to the parking lot, to join us in our services over Facebook and later on YouTube. So thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you for your giving. We appreciate so much your giving. And if you would like to give, you can give online. You can go to EWCEOnline.com, and you go up to the right hand corner where it says give, and you can support us online, and that is a blessing to us. It has really helped us to meet our budget and continue to teach and preach the word of God. So let me pray for you. Father.
Yes, thank you.
Help us as we put on this belt of truth, this belt of aletheia, that which is so tangible that we can see it, we can almost hold it. The truth that's revealed to us that when we become a child of God, we become righteous in your sight. That even when we misstep, even when we sin, mess up, and the devil points it out to us, you look down on us, you say, oh, all I see is the righteousness of my son.
Thank you.
That's one of mine.
Thank you,
Father. Lord, give us this truth.
Yes.
Let us take hold of this truth.
Yes.
And Father, for that one who feels the tugging of the Holy Spirit, that one who knows that they are lost, that if they was to leave this earth today, it would not be a heaven. It would be an eternal torment of hell. And they want to turn their lives over to you, but they'll tell you they mess up. But Lord, you want us to bring our message to you. Because then you take those messages and make a message out. So I ask today, without those help, that they'll invite Jesus Christ into their heart. And God, if they need more understanding than the writers here, any man who worships sin, come by even to see us. We would love. You know, our desire, our heart is for mankind to be saved. That's your desire. You say you're not willing that any should perish. You say it's your desire that all men be saved and walk in the truth. That's what you say. That's what you want from us. God, I pray today, may that be those who would heed his voice and receive you today and his righteousness. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for tuning in today. I hope you enjoy the message. Amen.